My name is Randy Cantrell. You can find this and a playlist of other sermons at randycantrell.com. Just in the navigation, click on In Thy Paths. Why hast thou forsaken me? The 22nd Psalm, verses 1 through 5. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou answerest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered. They trusted in thee, and were not put to shame. When you think about this question, why hast thou forsaken me, you immediately think of Jesus Christ on the cross. But as you heard, these are the first words of the 22nd Psalm. This chapter in Psalm has more lines that apply to Jesus than any other chapter. We often think of Psalm 22, 23, and 24 as the trilogy of Psalms about Jesus. Chapter 22 is about the cross. Chapter 23 is about the crook. And chapter 24 is about the crown. Now, we can take three different approaches to chapter 22. The first is the viewpoint of David because he wrote it. We could also look at it from the viewpoint of Christ because he completely fulfilled all the prophecy and the terms of it. We could also look at it from our own viewpoint because it was written and recorded for our learning. Romans chapter 15, verse 4, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that through patience and through comfort of the Scriptures we might have hope." This chapter contains a message of suffering. The first 21 verses of this chapter depict David's problem. Maybe these were problems that he experienced while Saul was pursuing him. David was a man after God's own heart. He experienced extraordinary success with the help of God, but he also endured many challenges, and he suffered some horrific problems. There are three fundamental problems spoken of throughout the book of Psalms. In these first 21 verses, David talks about all of them. First, he talks of feeling being forsaken by God. Verse 1, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from me and from the words of my groaning? Verses 6 through 8, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip, they shake the head, saying, commit thyself unto Jehovah. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, seeing he delighteth in him. Verse 11, be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Verse 19, but be thou not far off, O Jehovah, O thou my succor, haste thee to help me. Next, he talks of physical and perhaps spiritual illness. Verses 14, 15, and 17, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. And thou hast brought me into the dust of death. I may count all my bones. They look and stare upon me. And third, he talks about the persecution of powerful enemies. Verses 6 through 8 again, and also in verses 12 and 13. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gape upon me with their mouth, as a ravening and a roaring lion. And in verses 16 through 18, for the dogs have compassed me. A company of evildoers have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may count all my bones. And they look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them, and upon my vesture do they cast lots. The obvious prophetic importance of these passages, coupled with David's humanity, give us a lot to ponder. It's evident that David is perplexed. In spite of his problems, he will not forsake God and his faith. In the first 21 verses of this chapter, David's focus shifts constantly between his troubles and his reliance on God. Does that resonate with you? It does. It should. Vacillating between thinking about our problems and maybe thinking how much more we need God. Verses 22 through 31 display David's praise, perhaps after God has answered his prayers. David was a grateful man. God had blessed him, and he recognized it. And David would praise God in the midst of the assembly, he says, and he would encourage others to praise God too. Thankfulness and gratitude are necessary elements of a righteous life. David embraced these, and he shared his blessings. He wanted to bring others to know the true God, Jehovah. This psalm begins asking the question, why? And it ends with David's confidence in God, he hath done it, or he has performed it. When troubles come into our lives, we are tempted to feel that God has forsaken us. And perhaps in this pandemic that has been a global phenomenon, perhaps you've been tempted to feel that, where's God in all of this? It's important that we remember God never moves. He's always there, even in the middle of our most pressing difficulties, like now. Psalm 46, verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Our job is to maintain and grow our faith, increase our confidence every day in God, and be thankful for what God has done and what he continues to do for us, and to realize that if we remain true to God, then we will experience the victory that David experienced. This chapter also contains a message about salvation. When you heard me read that very first verse, your mind immediately went to Calvary and what the Lord said while he was dying. Jesus repeated that line as he hung on the cross. It is certain the Lord was pained by separation from God as he bore the sins of all mankind hanging on the cross, but he was most certainly speaking about the promise as well. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 11, searching what time or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did point unto, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that should follow them. The Lord knew what the result of his suffering was going to be. Hope of heaven available to all mankind. That was going to be the result of the death of Christ. Suffering in the Lord isn't just about pain and sorrow and sadness. It's about the reward of salvation at the end of all that. Our struggles aren't about the struggles, but the outcomes of those struggles. It's about the glories that will follow as long as we are following and faithful to God. In this 22nd chapter of Psalm, it gives us some very graphic pictures of the suffering of our Lord. Verse 16 talks about his hands being pierced. Listen to Luke's account, Luke chapter 23, verse 33. And when they came unto the place which is called the skull, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Luke 24, verses 36 through 40. And as they spake these things, he himself stood in the midst of them, and saith unto them, peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted, and supposed that they had beheld a spirit. And he said unto them, why are you troubled? And wherefore do questionings arise in your heart? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see. For a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye behold me having. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. John then reveals more after the Lord has risen in John chapter 20, verses 24 through 29. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Jesus cometh, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and see my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and put it into my side. Be not faithless, but believing. Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus saith unto him, Because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet have believed. Verse 17 continues the Lord's suffering and being stripped of his clothing. His humiliation just continued. He was literally a gazing stock. In verse 18, they cast lots for his clothing. The psalmist writes, They part my garments among them, and upon my vesture do they cast lots. Matthew's account in chapter 27, verse 35 confirms it. And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments among them, casting lots. Mark chapter 15, verse 24. And they crucify him, and part his garments among them, casting lots upon them, what each should take. Luke chapter 22, verse 34. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And parting his garments among them, they cast lots. John chapter 19, verse 24. They said therefore one to another, Let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which saith, They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. In our text chapter, Psalm 22, verses 6 through 8, show us the abuse the Lord suffered at the hands of the soldiers and the crowd. Matthew chapter 27 and Mark chapter 15, they depict the realities of it. Verse 8 also includes what the enemy said to the Lord. Commit thyself unto Jehovah, let him deliver him, let him rescue him, seeing he delighteth in him. The actual event is recorded in Matthew chapter 27, verse 43. He trusted on God, let him deliver him now, if he desireth him. For he said, I am the Son of God. Luke 23:35, and the people stood beholding, and the rulers also scoffed at him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if this is the Christ of God, his chosen. Throughout this pain and throughout all of this suffering, the Lord endured. But he did cry. He did cry out in his suffering. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 46, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? All of this suffering, that wasn't the point. Salvation was the point. Salvation for all mankind, that was the object of it all. Psalm 22 anticipates the glory of the Lord. Many blessings would stem from the suffering of the cross. The Lord would be resurrected, he would ascend back to the Father, and the church would be established and experience rapid growth. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 12 is a quote from verse 22 of the 22nd Psalm, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I sing thy praise. What do we learn from all this? David was just a man. The Lord was both man and God. Suffering is part of life here for everybody. That was true for David, just the man. That was true for the Lord, both man and God. Nobody is immune from suffering in this life. In the middle of our suffering, we may be prone to feel just like King David did. Maybe we can feel like the Lord felt. That is, we can feel forsaken, but we're not. In our suffering and in our trials, God is able to serve us and have his will accomplished. No, God isn't the author of our suffering. God is not the author of this pandemic. But God is powerful enough to use it for our good and for his good. The big question asked and answered by this chapter in the 22nd Psalm is, why? Why? Now we know why. That's easier to see once we've come out the other side of the sorrow and the sadness and the pain. As you're experiencing whatever difficulties have come your way because of this pandemic or anything else in your life, it's easier to lament than it is to have courage. It is easier to feel sadness and sorrow and abandonment than it is to remember that we're not alone, not if we're serving God. And it's more difficult to see past our current bad circumstance. We can study the scriptures and we can take various journeys throughout the ancient past where challenges just seemed enormous, well, because they were. We can study that story about those walls of Jericho. We can study about Goliath of Gath. I mean, these are enormous challenges that the people of God faced. We can think about Joshua and David serving to lead people through some torturous times, relying on God's word, relying on their own commitment to remain faithful no matter what. And in all of these stories, in all of these stories of the faithful, dedicated, righteous, we find victory. We find an outcome that seemed impossible until you realize that God, the great creator, he was behind it. He was behind the victories. Victory is in the Lord. In 1939, Eugene Monroe Bartlett, he wrote a song that maybe you're thinking of, Victory in Jesus. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and he caused the blind to see. And then I cried, Dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. I then obeyed his blessed command and gained the victory. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. Oh, in some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6 says, All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And Jehovah hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4, And that he was buried, and that he hath been raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Christ suffered so we could have more than hope. He suffered and died so we could have heaven. Victory. Mr. Bartlett got it right. But what about David's suffering? What about our suffering? Well, suffering happens to all of us. We can go through it with God. We can go through it without God. Whatever seemingly insurmountable odds we face, the urgent thing is for us to face our challenges, face our struggles, face our pains, face our suffering with God and not without God. You get to decide. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? For if God is for us, who is against us? Proverbs chapter 13, verse 15. Good understanding giveth favor, but the way of the transgressor is hard. Imagine all of these ancient stories of victory. Can you imagine them even happening without God? Can you imagine those walls of Jericho? They would have never fallen. Goliath would have never been defeated by David, a shepherd boy. The outcomes would have been very, very different without God. There would have been no victory. These colossally large adversities, they weren't any match for God. The greatest physical foe in this life is death, and even death is no match for God. That doesn't mean you're going to overcome death. It's appointed unto all of us to die, and then the judgment. But death in this life isn't the end. It's just the beginning of eternity. Romans chapter 6, verse 9, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death no more hath dominion over him. Romans chapter 8, verse 37 through 39, Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54 and 55. But when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? Your willingness to submit and sacrifice your will to God's will, that's the only thing that God will not conquer. Through his word, he will help you do it if you make up your mind. And that's on you, to give up yourself, to sacrifice your will, and to fully devote your life to him. David's suffering, depicted here in the 22nd Psalm, was with God. What if David had abandoned God? What if David had not walked with God? Imagine the outcome. No victory. Instead, it would have been the common outcome every time people abandon God. And every time people abandon God, there is catastrophic failure. Each of us need to make up our minds and keep making up our minds that we are going to travel through our problems and through our suffering and through our troubles and through this pandemic and whatever else happens to us in life with God. If you've not joined yourself to God by obeying his Son, Jesus Christ, I implore you to do that. And if you've done that, I implore you to refuse to leave God. Refuse to lose faith in God. Battle the feeling that God has abandoned you by making sure that you have not abandoned him. Be thankful for the blessings of this life. Acknowledge God. Give God the glory. Give God the honor. And that really is the whole point of it all. It's the point of all these stories that we read about in the Old Testament of great victories that God's people experienced. God wants the glory. He wants the honor. And he deserves those things, so don't rob him of those things. Find comfort in your sorrow in the Lord, knowing that the outcome of our suffering in Christ is eternal, an eternal reward in heaven. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in Jehovah with all thy heart, and lean not upon thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy paths.